Very good morning to you all, and a very warm welcome to this lecture under the aegis of the NEAS Literary Arts and Heritage Forum, which I convene. I'm Professor Sharada Srinivasan from the National Institute of Advanced Studies, based here in Bangalore. And our mandate under this program is also to look at the interdisciplinary interfaces between the arts, the humanities, and the literature, and also looking at aspects of conservation. And we have a very active program here at NEAS to do with archaeomaterials and materials heritage, which I've also been particularly involved with the metallurgical heritage. And we are very privileged to have with us today very eminent scholar and one of our most outstanding conservators, Dr. Subbaraman, who has been engaged over several decades in this very arduous and frontline area to do with conservation science. And he has, of course, worked on the conservation of paintings and bronzes and a range of materials, but he has made some very seminal and landmark contributions, particularly in the area of mural conservation. Of course, India has a very rich tradition of murals, and the conservation of this forms a very fascinating topic in terms of the history of conservation science. So this lecture, which I requested him to give, which he's very kindly agreed to, is also in part a historiography of this very fascinating subject, going back to, as he mentioned, to the early conservation work, which began at the spectacular site of Ajanta in those days, also going back to the East India Company, and then the Italian restoration under the Nizam of Hyderabad. And then he would also touch on the ground laid by late Dr. Paramasivan, who was also one of the very eminent conservators in the pre-independence era of the government museum at Chennai. And yes, I'm afraid there is some background noise. I can't help it. There's some puja going on here. So there's some very loud nadaswaram. So please bear with me. But I will mute myself once Professor starts talking. And then, of course, he's been involved with some very pioneering restoration projects, which he will talk more about. The Pallavas, Kanchipuram, Lepakshi. And he was also been involved with the separation of the spectacular Radheshwara murals of the Chola and Nayaka period, which is a very important and very careful job to have been done. And so he's been the superintending archaeological chemist with the ASI for over a decade. And also been with the intact Chitrakala Parishad for many years. And his work has also spanned, he's also visited and spent time, he was telling me, not just a fleeting visit, but he was based in Bamiyan for at least a couple of months. So he's seen those Buddhas up close and work on the conservation. And also, of course, Angkor Wat. So he's really, I think, seen some very important and historic facets. So this is going to be a very fascinating and important lecture. And thank you, and over to you, Professor Subbaraman. And I will mute myself now so that you don't have to hear that Nadaswaram music, which I, as I said, I apologize for.
Thank you, Professor Sharada Srinivasan, for the very warm introduction. And good morning to everyone. When Professor Sharada asked me to give this talk, I felt like an old thespian being recalled to the stage after a long time. And then accepted after some hesitation. And I am glad I did. I'm glad to have this opportunity of sharing some of my experiences with an elite audience like this. I have known Dr. Sharada for a long time. We met at a seminar at the Indira Gandhi Center for the Atomic Research at Kalpakkam for the first time in 1997. And since then, I have closely followed her entire body of work, her outstanding contributions in heritage science, her integrating science, art, as well as high philosophy in a study of the icon of Nataraja, and being a classical dancer herself, being a very notable example of the fusion of art and science herself. So thanks again to you, Dr. Sharda. And then my greetings also to Professor Ranganathan, the eminent metallurgist, who is also associated with this program in NIAS. NIAS Heritage Vision is also there. I know him also for quite some time. Now, we all know that we have a incredibly rich cultural heritage, magnificent monuments with architectural grandeur, sculptural wealth, and some of them have beautiful mural paintings, which are very important part of this heritage. When we speak of mural paintings, we refer to paintings on a prepared surface as distinct from the prehistoric cave paintings, which were done directly on the rock surface. The prepared surface in the earlier stages, it was a clay plaster. In India, as well as elsewhere. In India, from about the 7th century onwards, lime plaster came to be used. After the plaster is applied on the wall and it dries, the painting is done with paint prepared by grinding powdered pigments with an organic binding medium like a gum or a glue. This technique is called the tempera technique. The earlier paintings, almost all of the Indian mural paintings are in tempera. However, there is another technique called the fresco technique, where lime itself is the binding medium. And then painting is done on the lime plaster when it's still wet. This is called the true fresco technique, which has been in practice in Europe from very, very early times. Some of this technique did not take root in India. Here, the majority of the paintings are in the tempera. Or there is a third technique called the secco, where the medium is only lime, but it is done on a dry lime plaster. So some of the Indian mural paintings are said to be in secco.
Professor Raman, would you tell me when you would like me to share the screen? Would you like to share it now? Okay, I'll share the screen and you can keep talking alongside, yeah?
Sure.
Yeah, do you see the screen?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
I'll now talk a little more and then come to the slides later, huh? Okay?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. The earliest of the Indian murals are, as we all know, are in Ajanta. There are paintings there from the 2nd century BC up to the 4th, 5th centuries AD. Then come the Bach caves, about the same period, 4th, 5th century AD. Then we come to Ellora, where we have paintings of the 7th century AD. Next in the chronological order are in the Kailasanatha temple in Kanchipuram, early 8th century of the Pallava period. And we have Sitthana Vasal near Puthukottai, where we have 9th century paintings of the Pandyan period. And then we have in Brihadeeswara temple, the Tanjavur, the Chola paintings of the 11th century. And these can be said to be the last example of a classical style represented by Ajanta. Later paintings are all in what may be called the folk style. We have paintings of the Vijayanagara period in the Virupaksha temple, and late Vijayanagara paintings in the Lepakshi temple, and then in the succeeding Nayaka period of the 16th and 17th centuries, we have paintings in a number of temples, especially in Tamil Nadu. And about the same period in Kerala, temples also, number of temples have paintings. And then in palaces and other secular structures in the medieval period, all over India. So we have a really great treasure, and obviously we have to take proper care of them in order to be able to pass them on to the next generations in as good a condition as possible. Conservation actually involves first identifying the factors causing the deterioration of the paintings, then eliminating them, and then trying to bring back the paintings to their original condition as far as possible. And thirdly, to take steps to prevent future deterioration as far as possible. The mural painting actually is a layered structure. It has got three layers. First, the ground. First is the support. It may be the stone or the brick wall. Then comes the ground. The ground may be clay plaster or lime plaster, etc. And then the paint layer. So the conservation aims at treating all the three surfaces, all the three layers, see that they're in proper condition, as well as ensure the close adherence of the layers with one another. First of all loose or bulging portions of the paintings have to be fixed back to the wall. This is done normally by injecting a paste of calcium casein behind the ground, and then keeping it pressed to the wall for some hours, having some arrangement to keep it pressed to the wall arrangement until the lime sets, and then the ground is firmly adhering to the wall, like that. Any portions which are bulging, also through a small hole, we just inject this consolidant inside, and then keep it pressed for some time until it sets. All loose edges have to be again fixed Earlier times, we used to use plaster Paris for this purpose. But it's now felt that plaster Paris will have some disadvantages. And so the lime plaster itself is used even for fixing the edges. Next comes the cleaning. The painting surface may be covered with number of accretions like dust, dirt, or even sooty matter or oily matter. And in caves and all that, even bad droppings, wood droppings, all these things. So they have to be removed. So the cleaning aims at two things. First, the aesthetic aspect. The aesthetic aspect of removing all these disfiguring accretions and then bringing back the paint surface to as good a condition as possible. And secondly, to get rid of the accretions which may be having adverse chemical effects on the paint surface. So the cleaning is important from both these aspects. Our Indian murals having water-soluble medium like gum or glue, we can't use any aqueous solutions for cleaning. We have to use only organic solvents. And before using the solvent, of course, careful testing has to be done in a corner to see how effective the solvent is and whether the solvent is safe or not. After the cleaning is accomplished, the third step is applying a preservative coat. Normally, mural paintings don't require a varnish as oil paintings and others do. The surface is expected to be matte only, not shiny. But with regard to old mural paintings, where the surface may have become very friable due to aging and all that, application of a coat, a thin coat of preservative, is advisable to fix the powdery colors and all that firmly, and then also to afford it some protection from the atmospheric agents. So normally we use a preservative called polyvinyl acetate. A very thin solution is applied as a preservative coat at the end. Now, another question in this conservation process is how to go about filling any losses which may have occurred in the painting if some portion has been lost. What to do about it? In the Archaeological Survey of India, we never did any sort of retouching, even in a small portion. Even if part of the face is removed also, we don't recreate the face. So retouching was completely to be avoided. Any gaps and loose portions are simply filled up with plaster, with lime plaster, and then tinted suitably so that it will not remain very prominent. In conservation, it's always advisable to use materials which are as close to the original materials as possible. And the second principle is, we must use in the use of consolidants, etc., they have to be reversible. So at any stage in the future, if you feel they have to be removed, they have not been doing good work and all that, it has to be removed and all that, you should be able to remove. So the process has to be reversible. These two principles we always, always keep in mind. Now we can go to the slides.
Yeah, sure. So you're looking at the first slide here. Should I go to the next slide?
Yeah, next.
Okay. Yeah, one sec. I think you have to, are you in, are you on the full screen?
Yeah.
You see the full screen, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Now? Yeah. Okay, so this was, this is Ajanta, of course. You're seeing Ajanta, right?
Exactly. Please keep it there. You know, these are the famed Ajanta caves. Ajanta caves, this is only a partial view. If you go to a higher level on the opposite side, you will get a very beautiful panoramic view of the half moon shaped hill.
Next slide.
This is another view of the caves. Please hold it here. There are 30 caves in all, and paintings are there only in 4 or 5 of them. Cave number 1, 2, 16, and 17, and to some extent in number 6 and 11. The other caves, only fragments are there. Originally, all the caves should have been painted, but in the other caves, it has been lost. There is another interesting history of the Ajanta caves. Around the 6th century also, the bhikshus who used to be there, who used to live there, for some unknown reason, they deserted the caves. And then the caves were lost to the outside world for almost 1,000 years. There was a thick jungle growth and all that. And then nobody outside the outside world, except the local people who were there, they knew about the existence of the caves. And they were rediscovered in 1819 by a group of East India Company soldiers who came there for hunting. And they must have seen the tallest of the caves, cave number 10, tallest of the cave from that height. Probably the arch was still visible, and they came down out of curiosity and peeped inside, and they were amazed to see paintings inside. So the East India Company immediately took steps to clear the jungle, all that. And then rainwater had accumulated up to about 4 feet inside all the caves. So all that was drained. And then the crumbling structures were repaired.
Should I go to the next slide?
No.
Okay.
No.
Yeah. Sure.
So under Major Gill, actually, they sought that the initial structural repairs, etc., were done. You know the cave, the word cave, and hearing the word cave, we may get an image of a small dark place and all that. It is not like that here at all. They are huge halls, 100 feet by 80 feet, etc., etc., huge hall. And the rock is a volcanic rock called the Deccan Trap, and quite a hard rock actually. So how they carved into the rock surface such a hard rock and made such a huge caves inside, itself seem to be marveled, actually. Next slide, please.
Yeah, do you see the next slide?
Yeah. These are the fame Rajanta painting. This is fame number one, etc. Though the archaeological survey of India was started in 1861, and then the chemistry branch started in 1917. And yet the credit for the first concept project should go to the Nizam of Hyderabad. That was it, you know.
Can you hear me, Professor?
No, some sort of too much of disturbance was there. So
yeah, one sec. Yeah. I was trying to put on some headphones to stop that background.
Yeah.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's all right now. Yeah. I've put on some headphones, so I think it's okay now. Yeah, carry on.
So the Nizam of Hyderabad, he took up the first ever conservation project of mural paintings in India. So he invited two Italians, one Signor Cecconi and Count Arsini. And they did work for 2 seasons of 4 months each, and in 1920 and 21. They did a remarkable job of fixing all the loose portions and all that, consolidating all that work. He did very, very well. Cleaning also. Are you hearing the sound? Are you?
Yeah, it's coming and going. I'm hearing you now.
Yeah.
Now you're back.
So it's okay. After the discovery of the caves, in the 1840s, artists used to come from England to make copies of these paintings. And every time they came, they applied a varnish coat on the paint surface so that it can look brighter and all that, it will be easier to copy. And the Lady Herringham came in the 1840s. And visit from the J.J. School of Art, Bombay. He came with a student in the 1870s and all that. So as a result, number of coats of varnish had been applied on the paint surface. So these Italian restorers had to remove.
Hello.
After the entire consolidation treatment and then cleaning was over, the Italian restorers applied a coat of shellac as a preservative. The shellac, of course, it served a very good immediate purpose. It brightened the whole paint surface very much. But later, due to oxidation, the shellac coat has gradually turned yellow and in brownish places. So, altering the color values in the paintings considerably. So you can see
Can you hear me?
No, the sound, you know, this puja sound.
Yeah.
Huh? This puja sound is too loud.
Oh, puja sound is still there. I'm using headphones. So I'm prepared, still coming. Yeah.
I'm getting it.
You need to mute yourself.
You need to mute yourself.
Yeah, but the thing is, I don't know how to go to the control. Can somebody mute me?
No, we control with you only. Who's
You started the meeting. You need to mute yourself.
But the thing is that I'm here on full screen. I don't know how do I. Shall I go to escape? Will that get me the?
Just go to escape and right. Bottom there is a three symbol. Is that no mic symbol? Just mute the mic.
Speakers, headphones.
On yeah. Top. Can you see on top?
No, the thing is that if I do that, then because I'm. Oh wait a minute. Let me see. Okay. Fine.
Yeah, fine. It's correct. Now you're right. Yeah. So now you can start your talk, sir.
Okay. It's fine.
Thank you. Now.
So this discoloration. The discoloration of the shellac coat, that poses the main problem for us now. Reverting back to briefly to the scientific analysis, of the mural paintings of India, the pioneer in that field was Dr. S. Paramasivan. He was at that time, the curator of conservation at the Madras Museum. He had also the distinction of introducing there the electrolyte cleaning of bronzes. And he undertook this scientific examination of the technique of Indian mural paintings and analyzed samples from number of sites, including Ajanta, Ellora, Lepakshi, Kailas, and all that. He found, generally he found that all the pigments used are all mineral origin, and then the binding medium is used is some sort of a gum or a glue, etc. And of course he used only the simple analytical techniques which were available to him at that time. But my regret is that not much work has been done since then to analyze these pigments as well as the binding medium and all that using modern techniques. It may be comparatively easier to identify the pigments with the XRDA, etc. But identifying the medium may be a more difficult problem because the quantity of sample will be very, very small, available will be extremely small and all that. And then the medium itself might have undergone alteration, chemical alteration, but still highly sensitive techniques like mass spectrometry combined with gas chromatography, etc., could be useful to identify. And if you can identify the binding medium used in Ajanta, no doubt it will be extremely, it would be a very great interest. During my tenure in the ASI, I did try to interest some scientists of the regional research laboratory at Hyderabad, and then the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore and all that, to undertake some analysis on our behalf. But unfortunately, my effort did not yield fruit because these scientists were all very busy with their own work and all that. I couldn't have it done. I wish someone takes up such a project. Maybe NIAS. It should be a very, very interesting project. Next slide, please. This is again that famous Padma Pani figure, very, very important. Next. Next. Yes, yes, we can hold it there for some time. So we started our work. We started our work in the 50s, in the mid-50s. So our task was to remove this shellac coating. Obviously, we can't use any aqueous solution and all that. We have to use organic solvent to remove it as far as possible. And we found that several solvents we tried, isopropyl alcohol, amyl acetate, diacetone alcohol, or what's called cellosol, ethylene glycol, monoethyl ether. So these solvents, and sometimes a mixture of the solvents could be even more useful than a single solvent and all that. So the solvent is taken in cotton swabs and all that, and then gently rolled over the paint surface. We should not use too much of abrasion because the paint surface will be harmed and all that. And we also used another technique. We just soaked filter paper of a suitable size, maybe 12 inches by 12 inches, soaked this solvent, put it in the paint surface, cover it with a tin foil, and allow it to react for some time, maybe half an hour, 45 minutes, and then remove the filter paper, and then the partly dissolved shellac layer, remove with the help of cotton swabs. So in this way, we did the cleaning. But sometimes some problems would arise because several layers are there. So if you remove the first layer, varnish, and then another layer remains behind it, which has been disrupted because of this cleaning, but not completely removed, then we had some sort of a chalking effect, means some whitish coating will appear. And it would appear to onlookers as if we have spoiled the painting. Actually, it is not that. It's only because of the partial removal of the layer underneath. If that is also removed completely, we get the colors in their original form and all that. So this way we did our work in a patient way for a number of years and all that. Another question which you have to consider is what should be the qualification for a man who does such a work? Conservator. Simply the knowledge of chemicals and solvents alone is not enough. He has to have some manual skills. In addition, he should also have some amount of artistic sensibility, and then the feel for the paintings. Then only he can be a successful conservator. Next slide, please. Next. Again, Ajanta paintings. Ceiling view. Next. Now we come to Lepakshi in Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh, this is on Karnataka Andhra border actually. This is only about 70 miles from Bangalore. So this is a view of the what's called the Natya Mandapa, of the front portion, where the ceiling has got paintings. Please, next slide. Lepakshi is also known for its huge bull, which is there at a slight distance from the temple. It is standing alone. And this happens to be the biggest bull in India, about 27 feet in length and 14 feet in height. Next, please. When I went there in 58, the paintings outside had already been treated by my colleagues earlier. And I had to tackle, paintings were inside the main hall in the interior of the temple. And it being a living temple, because of oil lamps and constant burning of camphor and all that, the ceiling had been completely covered by a layer of soot. The ceiling had actually a large figure of 16 feet in length, 16 feet in length Veerabhadra figure. It had been completely covered with soot because only see paint outlines. So otherwise the ceiling was black. And my task was to remove the soot layer. To remove the soot layer without affecting the paint layer in any way. And being on the ceiling, it's a tough job to do. For the removal of the soot, I used a solvent called triethanol amine. It's a fairly viscous solvent. And it will remain for some time without evaporating on the paint surface. It dissolves the soot. And it's a effective as well as a very safe solvent for the removal of soot. And I used to apply it with the help of tissue paper, apply it on the surface, and then apply triethanolamine. Leave it for some time, half an hour, 45 minutes. Remove the tissue paper, and then the partially dissolved soot, carefully remove with cotton flaps dipped in petroleum spirit. Petroleum spirit, being a neutral solvent, has no effect on the paint surface. So this, of course, it's a very painstaking job. So slowly, and all that. This huge figure, which was practically invisible, it came out. It's a large figure with five hands on each side. We don't see it very clearly in this picture. Five hands on each side, each hand holding a different weapon, and high ornamentation and all that. The whole figure came out from behind this suit, as if it's coming out from behind a screen. So the effect was very, very pleasing to us who did the work. Next, please. This is another suit covered layer. Next. These are all on the outside, ceiling on the outside area, which had already been treated when I went there. Lots of Shaivite themes. Next, please. Shiva in the middle. Next. This is the famous Kiratarjuna story. where Arjuna does penance for Shiva to attain Pashupatastra, and then a boar appears and all that, and then both aim their arrows at that and they fight over it. So it's an important story in the Mahabharata, Kiratarjuna story. Yes, so many Shaiva themes in these paintings. And these paintings also are known for the very number of textile designs and all that. Yes, please. Next. This is another famous Manuniti Chola's story, where the cow appears to the king because the prince had run over her calf. So the cow appears, and the king renders a justice. It's a very popular theme in Tamil Nadu, but it's there here. So showing the interactions in that area, and then Vijayanagara itself had extended up to the far south. So no wonder. Next. Another Vipakshi painting. Next. Next. Now we come to the Kailasanatha temple, Kanchipuram. This is the early Pallava temple of the it's the Pallava temple of the early 8th century AD, built by Rajavarman. In the early part of the 20th century, the Archaeological Survey of India entrusted the central PWD with the conservation work. And in this temple, because the stone was deteriorating badly, the CPWD had covered the entire surface with lime plaster as a sort of a protective measure. And unfortunately, they also covered the murals inside. Number 52 sub-shrines are there around the main temple, and each sub-shrine has got murals. And they had covered the murals also with lime wash. So here our problem was removal of the lime wash and then exposing the painting. To remove the lime, we can't use any chemicals, because the only possible chemical which can remove the lime is some sort of an acid, and then the weakest acid can have disastrous effect on the painting underneath. So use of any chemical was ruled out. So the only way available to us was to remove the lime wash mechanically using tools like scalpels, even spatula, scalpels, blades, and all that, and then removing the lime wash inch by inch, and expose the paintings. In this way, we expose all these hidden paintings from underneath the lime coat. Next, please. These are all inside the 52 sub-shrines around the main temple. Next. All these we expose that the painstaking process of removing the live wash, bit by bit. Next. This is how it looked when the lime was still there. Yeah. Next. No. Next. This is after the removal of the lime wash. The previous one was, it was still covered with lime wash. This is after the removal of the lime wash. Next. Same painting, portion of it, the whole portion. As I was explaining earlier, you know, if there's any gap and all that, we don't do any sort of refilling or repainting and all that. We don't do it. Because the smallest addition which we make, it will interfere with the authenticity of the old painting. So we strictly avoid any sort of retouching in restoring these paintings. Just preserve them as they are. Next, please. Here, this is a Jain temple in Kanchi called the Trailokinatha Temple of Kanchipuram. So this was not under the control of ASI. This was under the control of the State Department of Archaeology. And this presents a perfect example of how not to do things. The State Department of Archaeology at that time, I don't know, under whose advice, they simply asked an artist to do the restoration. And he did whole scale retouching. Now, if you go, those who had seen it earlier, if you go there now, you can't distinguish between the old and the new. The whole ceiling, it looks like a new painting now. Completely ruined, actually. And then the State Department of Archaeology, they have done that. Sad thing. Next one, please. Next slide, please. Next. This is the famed Brihadeeshwara Temple, Tanjavur, which is an architectural masterpiece. Next. Yeah. Please hold it there for a time. Here, we were faced with a unique conservation problem. Around the sanctum, the circumambulatory passage around the sanctum had been painted even in the Chola period. The walls of this passage had been painted in the Chola period itself. Early 11th century AD. By about the 16th century, when the Nayaka lawyers were there, probably some damage had occurred in the Chola paintings due to age. Some portions probably had fallen off or something like that. And then the Nayakas at that time, they did not like any sort of damaged portion, etc. And nor was the idea of preservation and conservation as we have now, it was not present at that time. Their thinking was different. If they could not tolerate the damaged thing, they wanted to have a completely new thing. So they replastered the entire area and then repainted in their own style. So as a result of that, from about the 16th century onwards, there were two layers of painting there, the Chola layer underneath and above that the Nayaka layer. But in the year 1933, Professor Govindaswamy of the Annamalai University, he came there with his students and all that, and while looking at the paintings, he could see some portion of the upper Nayaka layer, so probably had fallen off. So he could see another layer underneath. And he surmised it must be of an earlier period. Earlier period, maybe of the Chola period and all that. He published an article about that. In the 40s, in the late 40s, when the Archaeological Survey of India took over this monument for protection and all that, the question of exposing these hidden Chola paintings, it came up. So they thought, the people in charge at that time, they thought the only possible way was probably to sacrifice the upper Nayaka layer in order to expose the Chola layer. So they simply carefully chipped off bit by bit and exposed the Chola layer. Chola paintings. We can have a look at some of the Chola paintings now, please. Next slide. Another view. Yes. This is Chola paintings. As I said earlier, there is a classical style of Ajanta and all that. There's a beautiful line drawing, and then a sort of a refined color scheme and all that. On the other hand, the superimposed Nayaka layer, it was far inferior in artistic quality. Crude drawing, garish colors and all that. It was far too inferior. So they thought that sacrificing the Nayaka in order to expose the Chola, it was no big deal and all that. They thought at that time was probably, and then they thought it was the only practicable way. So at that time. Later, next please. We can have a look at some of the Chola layers. This is the image of Nataraja in chamber 9, I think, 9. And we don't see it in this picture. In front of the Nataraja, Rajaraja Chola himself, along with his three queens, is standing on this side. We don't see it in this picture. Next. This is the famous Tripurantuka panel in chamber 11. Shiva